So, I think we can start. Good afternoon to all, to the PhD students of the PhD program of in political science and sociology of the Scuola Normale, to the PhD students of other programs in the main site of the Scuola Normale in Pisa. As you probably know, we have we are going to have this internal seminar with Zygmunt Bauman. Theoretically, I should present or I should introduce who is Zygmunt Bauman, but frankly speaking, I think it is not necessary. You perfectly know who Zygmunt Bauman is, and this exactly because his CV and his reputation, we are extremely pleased and honored to have the opportunity to hear something from him. The idea is to have a full presentation of around 50-60 minutes around a great, or I would say, interesting topic, offline and online, and then the floor will be yours. So you could give or you can propose on the, some questions to Zygmunt Bauman. I think that other words could waste time, so please, Professor Bauman, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. I don't know whether you hear me.
Do you?
Do you hear me? Right, okay. I owe you to say...
Maybe you could stay sitting and speaking.
I prefer to stand, really.
If you then like, but you know, could be a bit...
then I can see faces, you know.
Okay. Abbiamo un... We have the microphone, so you can take it.
Aha, all right. That's on? All right. So I owe you to explain the title, what I'm going to talk about, the major message I want to convey. The message is that for the first time in history of humanity, we live simultaneously in two different worlds. And when I say we, I really mean we, all of you, including myself and even Professor Capari. We are living in two worlds. There were periods in history, very many of them, when there were some people who inhabited two worlds at the same time. All the saints, for example, who lived simultaneously in kingdom of God and kingdom of man, there were people hiding and forced to conduct double life, to pretend to be someone in one world and someone else in another. But today's situation is different. We willy-nilly, whether we selected deliberately or just fall victim of the fate, we are living in two different worlds. Each one of them has its own laws, its own rules of proceeding, its own Weltanschauung, the view of the world, the attitudes which are proper to it, and so on. What are these two worlds? Some people say one is internet, the other is the real world. I rather wouldn't use this distinction because I'm not quite sure which of the two worlds is more real. I think that the gravity, the center of gravity in contemporary world moves from what used to be called the real world out there in the street to your contact, not with human faces, but with the screens, whether they are screens of desktop or laptop or iPhone, doesn't matter really. But you are contacting a screen which is an entry into a different kind of world. And that's why I prefer to speak about online and offline, because the world, the point of reference, the starting point in which you try to imagine what is really the matter of fact, what is really happening, is the online. There is where we get something like 95% of all our knowledge, which is in our heads, and you approach the world which you live, when you go out to the street, or when you go to the place of work, or when you go to the university seminar, is defined, is articulated by comparison with this first one. So I'm not sure which one of the two words to call the real. You remember Emil Durkheim, who defined social facts as a real fact, as facts, as much facts like this table, for example. This table is real because I can't go through it. I have to go around, and I can't wish it away. I turn other way, it is still here. That is the recognition aspect, so to speak, of reality, of real facts. Which one is more real? Well, that is roughly the topic of what I'm going to discuss with you. I will start from telling you a very trivial fact, that among other things, the modern progress, the whole idea of progress, was to wage and win the war against every discomfort, inconvenience, and displeasure, which are, as you know from your own experience, very plentiful in everybody's life. And if you take that into account, then you can see the advent of World Wide Web, Internet, all this informatics, electronic, as the highest achievement so far reached by this push towards progress and against displeasure, discomfort, inconvenience. Internet is user-friendly. It gives you the ability to set your own code of law. Alain Finkielkraut, the French philosopher, put it very nicely. He put it, I quote, "The Internet is a monde sans foi ni loi." There are no particular faiths attached to it. You are free to choose it according to your preference. And no law. You are setting, you are codifying your own prescription and proscription. You select people whom you want to meet and deselect people meeting whom it doesn't give you pleasure and for one reason or another makes it inconvenient. So I would suggest that the first impression, the first approximation, mind you, it's not the last one, but the first one, that Internet is the wonder weapon with which to fight the inconveniences, discomfort of the other world, which we also occupy so far and cannot but occupy so far, namely what I call offline and what used to be understood as reality. Allow me to quote a rather lengthy quotation from Jonathan Franzen, the American essayist, American literary scholar, and very, very witty and very wise man, addressing commencement gathering at Kenyon College. He pointed out the following: the ultimate goal of technology, the telos of techne, is to replace a natural world, a world which is indifferent to our wishes, a world of hurricanes, hardships, breakable hearts, a world of resistance, with a world so responsive to our wishes as to be effectively a mere extension of the self. And he goes on saying that our technology, and he means above all the electronics, the informatics technology, has become extremely adept at creating products that correspond to our fantasy ideal of erotic relationship. What does it mean? It means that in the fantasy ideal of erotic relationship, the beloved object asks for nothing and gives everything. Instantly gives everything and makes us feel, for that reason, all powerful, and doesn't throw terrible scenes when it's replaced by an even sexier object and is consigned to a drawer. Or you experience these things when you threw away your iPhone 5 because iPhone 6 was introduced, you threw away iPhone 5 and there was no quarrel, no complaint, no grudge made by the object. Ideal love object. Fantasy of ideal love object. Well, there are really things which introduction of the internet changed our life very considerably, and most people would say, and I think that not without grounds, that change it to the better. First of all, if you ask why Mark Zuckerberg made his $50 billion on stock exchange, what was the capital? Well, from he got his tremendous wealth, tremendous capital, he really discovered a gold mine. A gold mine in question was our very widespread in contemporary times, in our liquid modern society, deregulated society, society full of uncertainty, impossible to predict what's going to happen to you next day, whether when you wake up tomorrow, the job which you perform will be still existing. Well, all sorts of uncertainties, frightening uncertainties. In this world, the very widespread feeling is the feeling of being abandoned, being impotent, being left alone, being left helpless and hapless, really. Fear of exclusion. Today I am firmly in my saddle. I have the social position to occupy and social task to perform. I am somebody, and tomorrow it may all disappear. I am constantly under the threat of being left alone. It's very difficult to find a young man or a young woman walking the street without keeping iPhone or another mobile telephone in hand. No wonder, because that is some sort of a magic wand which chases away the phantom, the very sinister phantom of being abandoned, of being alone. Thanks to Mark Zuckerberg and Facebook, well, you are never alone. Never again alone. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, there is somebody somewhere to which you can send a message, and somebody somewhere who will even reply to your message. So the feeling of being alone is never again haunting you. But before you were born, when the first mobile gadget of collecting, namely Walkman, was introduced. Walkman was introduced under the slogan, never again alone. And that is why it sold billions or hundreds of millions of objects under this title, because that was what already people said. The threat of being made lonely, of being forced into loneliness by exclusion. That was where the new phenomenon of the contemporary form of fear was born. Now, with internet, in many times more, many times more profoundly, you are feeling member of a bigger totality. You have your network. You have your network. You have tremendous easiness, tremendous facility to make friends. You have on the internet, you have hundreds of friends there. More friends than I managed to create during all my 90 years of life. You can do it in half a day if you want, if you are really industrious enough. It's a very simple activity to do. A network, unlike the real, offline communities, is composed and maintained by two activities, connecting and disconnecting. And you are in charge. Everybody is in charge. You can put in whoever you want. You can delete whoever you want. So I was always, always in charge of selection of those people with whom you want to communicate, and with selection of people with whom you would like rather not ever meet. The second tremendous improvement caused by appearance of internet is the fact that you have now direct, unmediated access to the public sphere. People always wanted to somehow attach themselves to the public sphere, to be reckoned with, to count for something. Friend journalist joked that if Descartes was with us here in this room, he would rearticulate his cogito, and he would say, "I am seen, therefore I am." And being seen means being present in public life. Still 20, 30 years ago, mind you, in order to get this distinction, you had to beg favors of a big company. There must have been a board of a glossy magazine to decide whether you are worthy of being put on the first page of the on the cover of glossy magazine. If you want to appear on television, there was powerful corporate bureaucracy with very carefully selected people who deserve to be let into the studio, and those people who should be kept away. And so on and so on. You were dependent on very great powers which you alone was unable to fight. You had to beg them their favors. Now it is not like that. Everybody can have a blog. Everybody can set into the cyberspace 1,000 tweeters a day. No problem. You don't ask permission. You do it yourself. And very funny, one of the American journals recently published a long list of most influential people in the world. And they were really among them, most of them, were people who are not prime minister, not president, not very rich, not particularly very rich, but who run a blog, which is very popular. There's a lot of likes and a lot of visits on their blog. So allegedly, supposedly, they influence quite the thinking and perhaps even action of very many people. So That's another achievement. Everybody is given a chance. Mind you, you don't, people know that chance of living the jackpot and lottery is minimal, but nevertheless, they keep trying. No, because if they stop trying, then they lose the chance, the one in million chance of living on a ticket in lottery, but they continue to go on. And that's a very powerful incentive for people to go on internet, just to expose yourself to unknown space, space which we call public, looking from our individual point of view. Perhaps it so will happen, it will so happen that somebody will find out our message and consider it very seriously and does something with it. Perhaps I will become a known person. According to the new cogito, I am seen, therefore I am. These are, ladies and gentlemen, undoubtedly blessings of introduction of internet. That's why people associate so many different hopes about a better world to live in, associate that hope, invest that hope precisely in the advent of internet. But, and here is a big but coming, I suggest to you that advent of internet is a mixture of blessing and a curse. There are curses as well, apart from blessings. I will name a few of them, and we will leave later to, for you to complement them or efface them from my list, deny their presence. But I suggest to you that the first, curse, the price which you pay for these blessings, which deserves to be put at the top of the list, is the collateral victim of informatics, namely the fading of attention, shortening of the attention span. We are, with internet, looks your task, puts as an ideal of your task the model of instant coffee. You just pour some powder and pour a little bit of hot water and immediately you can drink. Effects are immediately, now, without waiting. And we are getting used, ladies and gentlemen, to expect immediate effects. That is what we learn from living in the online world. I don't know about you, but if I ask Google for an answer and it takes more than 1 minute to answer it, not just give me one answer, but 5 million answers, then I feel very nervous and very angry. So long it takes. We need instant effects of our action. But it's not only one aspect, one problem with attention span. It is also the question that when your attention span is shortening and you are more and more impatient, waiting for immediate effects, then what is happening that you are simply unable to concentrate over a longer period of time. I fortunately retired from university regular teaching 25 years ago, so I don't know how it looks now in a regular university class. I am temporary visitors everywhere there, But my colleagues academics who are still there keep repeating that they need now to giving readings, obligatory readings to their students for the next seminar. They need to point from which page to which page. And that reading the whole article from a learned journal from the beginning to end for very many students is really above their ability to concentrate. They can't do it. And that's already a very great danger to the quality of our knowledge. Don't confuse, please, amount of information and the profundity of knowledge. They are two different things. You need, in order to acquire knowledge, you don't have just get information very quickly, but you have to allow it to settle, to get into touch with what already is settled there, arrive to some sort of a merger, blending, mutual relationship. John Steinbeck, the American novelist, famously compared ideas with rabbits. He said, you get a couple of rabbits, learn how to handle them, and pretty soon you have a dozen. The same is ideas. You get a couple, you learn how to handle them, and very soon you have 20 ideas. That's the problem. If you store information, misled by its easy accessibility, any moment you want, you can retrieve it, no problem. If you store them in Mojave Desert in America, where cloud interneting is settled, then of course they don't copulate, they don't cooperate, and therefore much less chance you have of combining the known into positing a question about unknown and finding others to that. So this is, ladies and gentlemen, a long-term danger. It is not something which affect we can already estimate fully today. History of online is too short for that, and we shouldn't jump to conclusion. But nevertheless, it is a real danger. It's the third unprepossessing result of the sharing our existence between two worlds of online and offline. Well, the other thing is what I already briefly mentioned, namely the question of selecting and reselecting a network of friends and keeping it as long as the heart desires. Well, as French sociologist, the other one, Jean-Claude Kaufmann, pointed out, it all feels so safe as long as one can log on with one click and log off with another click. Touching icons on screen, one can feel, however counterfactually, in complete control of social contacts and one's own position, which they imply. Well, it may be so, it may be not so. If you can really make 500 new friends in one day by adding simply with few movements of your fingers their names to the list of the members of network, then it really seems childishly easy. And even more so when it comes to breaking the relationship in offline world is tremendously difficult business and very unpleasant one. You have to lie, you have to invent non-existing causes of breaking, and you have to apologize and long after you still have guilty conscience and all sorts of things, all these concepts which are already half forgotten in our days, because we have the easy exit out of the trouble by using the key with the inscription delete on internet. Well, this is what applies to our personal qualities. Several dangers we should be aware of and think about it when we are trying to organize our life in this cut in the middle world, separating online rules from offline rules. Because you can't avoid so far, unless dystopia written by Michel Houellebecq, the great French contemporary writer under the title Possibility of an Island, unless this dystopia is already fulfilled. Because there, the offline world was completely abolished. There was no offline world. Every single individual spent his life from the beginning to end in the company of very perfect technology of informatics, but without meeting another human being. But so far it is not like that. And some people even don't believe that the dystopia of Houellebecq will ever be implemented. But nevertheless, there is a shock. There is a shock whenever we go out from the internet world, the online world, into the street. There you cannot simply avoid unpleasant presences. I wonder whether you saw the film made 30 or 40 years ago, even being there, there was a story long before internet became a common property of a man who spent all his life in artificial environment. Namely, he was a butler, a lackey of a rich man on an estate. He never left this estate, being in this service. He was there from childhood till advanced age. And the only contact with the world outside was a television screen. He knew the world from television screen. And then the rich boss died. The estate was taken over by the heirs, who fired the royal servant. He was forced to go into the street. The first sight he saw in the street was a bevy of nuns dressed black. Very sinister sort of a sight. He never saw it before. Fortunately, he never forgot his pilot, a TV pilot, so he took it from his pocket and tried to switch the nuns off. Unfortunately, they resisted, and they didn't reply to his command. And that's how his tragedy began. Now, in a minor edition, minor variety, we experience these sort of shocks virtually daily. When we are trained into making internet dates on the internet, that to make a real date with a real person becomes simply difficult. You fail to learn the skills which are necessary in interaction of two human beings. Interaction with a human being who is not quite, to remember Descartes, object to your subjectivity, but who are also subjects endowed with their own will, with their own preferences, own hierarchy of values, own character, and things like that. So there are such things. You are lucky enough to get a plum job you dreamt of, and you find yourself surrounded by people of different culture, different preferences, different points of view, a different way of behaving, and so on. And you know, and you are lost how to deal with this new unpleasantness, which you didn't expect, because life online did not prepare you to engage in real tackling of controversies, of differences between people, and so on. On the online, we can cut for ourselves, and that is a blessing, mind you, what I can call a comfort zone. A zone not in which all troubles, all controversies, all conflicts have been resolved, but the zone in which they were swept under the carpet, because you simply eliminate that conflict from there. The majority of social research about the way people use the internet is that, contrary to optimistic observation, that they will be more multi-sided, open to the world, because on internet you can be now, at this moment, in New Zealand, the other moment you can be in Honolulu, and you can be aware of things happening all over the world in real time. Expectations were that people will be therefore more open to the world, more open to the diversity of being in the world, different styles of living, more tolerant therefore, and in the end, more democratically predisposed. Social research of users of internet shows the opposite, that people tend mostly to eliminate unpleasantries which are to be found in offline world. Namely, cut this niche, safe niche in which there are no opponents. You can describe the comfort zone as an echo chamber. You know what echo is. In echo chamber, the only sounds which you hear are reflections of your own voice. Or you can call it hall of mirrors. And that means that the only sights which you see are the reflections of your face. You are contacting with people of whom you know in advance that they share your ideas, that they fit you like a hand in glove, that they will applaud what you are going to say. So when is the occasion to learn the skills which are necessary in the offline world? Namely, the dialogue with people who hold to the views which are abhorrent to you, which are not going to applaud you, which are going to criticize you, and even throw all sorts of aspersion on what you believe to be correct, what you believe to be right. So it doesn't help, actually, develop the progress of democracy. It does not mean that you can resolve the very disquieting problems of our contemporary world simply by making this world more alike online kind of universe. It is simply an online kind of universe can survive intact, can be applied, can be handled only in these relatively artificial surroundings, which are kept away from the daily life in the street. As I said, it only sweeps under the carpet the real troubles, the real worries, real concerns, real controversies of offline life. Ivan Khrushchev, I recommend it to your attention. I think he is a rising star of political science. He is a tremendously profound analyst of contemporary situation, and also very important pleasure to read because he is a very witty man. So Ivan Khrushchev points out in the connection I'm talking about to the rise of big data in politics, a role of big data in politics. That is the other aspect of online not helping the progress of democracy. The rise of big data in politics is allowing, he says, governments and large corporations to gather, organize, and instantly access nearly unlimited amounts of information about the preferences and behavior of behavioral patterns of citizens. Elites approach election as opportunities for manipulating the people rather than listening to them. Big data makes voting marginal as a source of feedback, while protesters against the elite prefer to use elections as occasions for demonstrations rather than as tools to shape policy. So degradation of citizenship, of the role of citizenship in political life on the one side, on the other hand side, magnifying of the manipulating ability, manipulating power, manipulating instruments on the side of the ruling elite. Which takes us to the possibility of alternative to this not the pleasant aspects of the departure of the change I am talking about. What are the alternative is? You probably know it very well, and you probably participated in it on one occasion or another. I already mentioned the question of demonstration, going to the public square, occupying public square, occupying Wall Street was a famous event in modern history, in recent history. Everybody talked about occupying Wall Street, except Wall Street itself, which hardly noticed that it was occupied. Nothing changed after the occupation. I am using the phrase square people. It was a phrase coined by Thomas Friedman, who just make a short, brief, but very sharp comparative research of pitching tents for a few days or a few weeks at the utmost on Tahrir Square, the Maidan Nezalezhnosti in Kiev, Taksim Square, Bolotnaya Square, Rothschild Square, Puerta del Sol Square, Syntagma, Altamir and Tsukhoti Squares, quite a lot of squares and quite a lot of people. The problem was that none of the major protest movements has come out with a platform for changing the world or even changing the economy. In this sense, I suggest to you, we may be looking less at a possible engine of revolutionary activity against unpleasant aspects of capitalism than an engine of capitalism safety, some sort of a safety valve, which you put into the machinery, into the steam engine, in order to prevent explosion. You just allow the steam to be unloaded, let off, before it acquires the really dangerous proportion. Well, Ivan Krastev, on his part, writes about square people, people who go to street and protest against without offering much in exchange. It is an explosion of political subjectivity. And like any explosion, it by definition cannot be sustained. The more violent explosions are, the shorter time they last. They end very quickly, they just disperse the energy which caused them in the first place. They serve as a very important psychologically, mind you, psychologically very important occasion to unload the long accumulated mistrust and anger and show just how strongly we feel against it. But from there to making world flesh is unfortunately rather far. So having told you that, having juxtaposed some very obvious blessings and some very obvious dangers which are connected with the new era, the era of the life divided between online and offline. Having done that, I must admit that I can't give you any positive answer, and I have to leave to your own imagination and your own resolve to find the answer which is still absent. What to choose? However, whatever you are choosing, one needs to choose it with understanding of what is involved. So please take into account these phenomena which are associated with introduction of technology which was hoped to resolve our human problems. Unfortunately, human problems have this quality that can be resolved only by human beings and their decisions and their choices. We are now in the result because we are in the middle of the road. I call it the period interregnum. Interregnum, that's a time when the old ways of doing things properly don't work any longer properly, but the new means, new ways which would replace them have not yet been invented and put in place. And I allow myself to finish, I'm talking too much already, to finish with quoting two aphorisms. Two aphorisms of the great Franz Kafka, which prophetically portray very, very exactly the kind of condition in which we find ourselves today. The first one: I heard the sound of a trumpet, and I asked my servant what it meant. He knew nothing and had heard nothing. At the gate, he stopped me and asked, "Where is the master going?" "I don't know," I said. "I just out of here, just out of here, out of here, nothing else. It is the only way I can reach my goal." "Ah, so you know your goal?" asked the servant. "Yes," I replied. "I have just told you, out of here, that's my goal." That's the first aphorism, and that applies to the nature, the consequences of the activity of Los Indignados. And the second answer, complementing the first: no one at all can blaze a trail to India. Even in his day, the gates to India were beyond reach, yet the king's sword pointed the way to them. Today, the gates have receded to remoter and loftier places. No one points the way. Many people carry swords, but only to brandish them. And the eye that tries to follow them is confused.
Thanks a lot, Professor Obama, for having given us this complex picture about to be offline and to be online. I was thinking if I am, I was comparing my mother, as we are speaking, my mother, who is completely offline, and myself, I am completely online. I was thinking about who feels better usually, but maybe I could go deep and after your questions. So the floor is yours. I expect some reactions. We have a microphone. We have
yes. microphone.
Who is the first one?
Yeah.
If you prefer to collect questions,
yes.
or the
no, yes,
can you introduce yourself, please?
Yeah, Lorenzo Mosca. I'm associate professor here at the Scuola Normale Superiore. I really enjoyed your presentation. It was very interesting, very challenging. I would like to raise 3 points, even if I think there are many points that...
Yes, yes, some
okay.
people are so you should...
Hi. There are many... Yeah, there are many points that I think should be discussed, but I just want to raise 3. So the first one, I really liked this idea of the virtual world with the real world, but I'm not really sure that it's correct to consider online and offline as two very different worlds. I see that you consider them as parallel and detached worlds, but I think that this divide has been very much bypassed in recent reflection, in the sense that the internet is seen as a complement to everybody, every everyday activity. So many scholars stress the continuity between the offline and the online world, not this strong detachment. So the embedment of the internet in the social world, the continuity with the everyday life, the fact that the offline society tend to be reproduced online. No? So we have also processes of colonization, for example, of the online world by offline traditional actors, both in the political, social, and in the media sphere. There are power law, there is power law, so I think also the boundaries between the offline and the online are very much blurred and confused. There is, for example, an interesting book by a British scholar, Andrew Chadwick, an interesting book, The Hybrid Media System, by Andrew Chadwick, where he shows very much this connection, this continuity between these two worlds. So this is the first point I wanted to raise. The second point concerns the openness and inclusivity of the online public sphere. That is also an important point. And you argued that now we have a direct and unmediated access to the public sphere thanks to the internet. I think it's This is certainly the case, but we should also consider that in the online sphere there are could call functional equivalent to the traditional gatekeepers. So search engines or social networks can be considered as functional equivalents to traditional gatekeepers. When you go to Facebook, you open a profile, it's like buying a flat in a building that where everything is almost already decided. You can choose the color of your kitchen, but you cannot choose the architecture of the platform, no? So there are also very important constraints and affordances from this point of view. And the third point I wanted to make concerns the square people you quoted, the square people in Zuccotti Park, Sintagma Square, or Puerta del Sol. And I think that it's very difficult to measure the effectiveness of social movements, at least in the short run. There is a big literature on the topic, on the outcomes of social movements. And but my impression is that some political alternatives that have risen against austerity measures, for example, in Greece, Syriza, or Podemos in Spain. My impression is that there is not a translation from the mobilization in the square, but probably they are related. So maybe this is a way to present an alternative to the austerity measures in Europe. So maybe I would like to hear your opinion on these three issues. Thank you very much.
Maybe you can represent.
I think that you can react to him because we should. Yes, because we should suppose we are supposed to collect questions, but he proposed at least three questions. Thanks a lot for this to be discussed, Anton.
Just a moment, because. The microphone is around. You prefer to know.
That's also aspect of my deafness, that no where when you hear or not, it sounds the same to me. There's no doubt that there is an interaction between the two spheres. I'm not suggesting that they are separated by untouchable and impregnable border between the two. Apart from everything else, the reason why they can't be so detached from one another is that in each of one of us, half of our personality lives here and half there. But both halves combine into our person. We are at the same time online and offline beings. So transmission from one to another is unavoidable. The only thing I was trying to tell you is that it is very difficult business that rules which are dominating, hegemonic in one of the two worlds are incompatible with the requirements of the other half. And you are full of conflict, you are bound to try day after day after day to resolve this contradiction and to adjust them, to do some sort of a hybrid personality which can absorb, which can spread both wings at the same time. But it is not easy. And the only point I wanted to make, I didn't suggest that like in Italo Calvino, the famous story about the knight which was cut into two halves. I am not suggesting that you are this knight of Italo Calvino and the two halves lead separate lives. One example is this question of openness which you raise. It's a very important really problem, because there is no question that
openness means taking a risk. Taking a risk. As long as you are enclosed in the magic circle of like-minded people, you are safe. Whatever you say will be applauded. Hurrah, hurrah, how nice, how wise you are. Yes, I agree absolutely with you, 100%. When you open up to the world which is full of contradictions and conflicts and antagonisms, different faiths, different religions, different cultures and so on, then you are taking the risk that you will not be always a winner. You can be always guaranteed winner only in a comfort zone. But in offline world, you have no guarantee to be winner. You may be proved wrong. And what human being likes to be proved wrong? Only masochists do, probably. I don't know, but I surmise that is the case. But normally, it is a very unpleasant feeling. You want to be right. When you go to university seminar, if you are an ambitious man, you are really active man, probably you would wish to document, to force all the other members of the seminar to accept your wisdom and to accept your verdicts that they are not as wise as you are. That is the hope. That's what you want to achieve. In out there, when there's no such a structure of university seminar, there is a teacher who has the power, and the students who has the duty to read and listen and write the projects and things like that. Now, then there is a constant risk, And that's why people are gladly accepting the opportunity to spend an important part of your life. According to the latest research, the average person between 16 and 25 years spends 9.5 hours a day in front of a screen of one kind or another. So it is quite a lot of good chunk of your life, and therefore it's a very tempting, seductive opportunity just to shelter you, to be safe from that things. And that is why openness, which I agree with you, is tremendously important condition of our collective survival in the globalized, cosmopolitized, diasporized world in which we inhabit, very important quality, openness. Nevertheless, it is tremendously difficult. Richard Sennett, great sociologist, one of the greatest living, offered the three-partite formula for dialogue, which he, like myself, considered to be an absolutely necessary condition of our collective survival in this globalized world. And he speaks about three elements which are necessary here: informality, openness, and cooperation. Informality means you don't set rules in advance, you don't set the agenda in advance, you are relying that they will come out by mutual agreement in the course of the dialogue itself. Openness means precisely openness to the possibility of being defeated. Now, that is the most awesome obstacle on the road to really open ourselves up. We write, to go to another area, very many people pay above their nose in order to buy themselves a flat in so-called gated communities. Gated communities. What they are paying for? They are not paying for flats. Flats are like flats. Everywhere are flats, you know. But what is there in addition is that not a single person who doesn't belong to the selected circle of acquaintances, friends, people like us, is allowed inside. So they are cut off from offline world, the real world out there. And the same we do very often on internet where we create our own network, and we by chance come across a website where you hear unpleasant views which we don't share, we have wonderful medicine. One finger is enough to press the keys, the key delete, and end of the story. The question is whether running away from the hardships, running away from the difficulties, whether it will really help the cooperation between these two worlds. And I'm afraid that that's a very serious obstacle. The third element in Richard Serrett's the formula is cooperation. He stresses that it is not the dialogue, the real dialogue is a cooperative, not competitive dialogue. When it is conducted with having the goodness of the both sides in mind, then there will be no division between winners and losers, because every participant of the dialogue will emerge from the dialogue enriched by acquiring from other partners information about the alternative possibilities, the other ways of resolving and facing the problems which are shared, and so on and so on. What was there? Square people. Yes, you used the phrase social movements. I have doubt. I don't see many social movements. I prefer to speak about social moments than social movements. There are social moments. There are social moments when you Twitter more and more friends, and friends Twitter other friends, their friends, and those friends Twitter yet more friends, and suddenly there are several thousand of people congregating on the square. Now, think for a moment. What brought those people to the square? The first famous square of this kind was Tahrir Square in Cairo. And to Tahrir Square came all sorts of people. They came unemployed, humiliated, impoverished people from the suburbs of Cairo, and the sons of very, very rich Egyptians who didn't see the correlation between their economic significance and their political significance, which was denied. And members of Muslim Brotherhood who felt oppressed in their religious beliefs and so on, people of very different standpoints. They were united only by one task, one issue gathering. The one issue gathering was to get rid of Mubarak. And that united them. That was the moment of unification. Once that goal had been achieved and Mubarak was off, there was no reason for them to stay together. They started quarreling with each other. How do you reconcile the rich center Cairo youngsters with Muslim Brotherhood, who wanted living in humility and misery and power in poverty? How could they recombine, unify these two tendencies? And that's why they are momentary. That's why they last as long as the short-lived purpose is achieved, or as long as it is made clear absolutely that this one point won't be met, won't be implemented, because two overwhelming forces are on the other hand. So we are still in searching. We are still looking for the really effective ways of dealing with this basically, essentially deregulated situation. I call sometimes this deregulated situation as the result of divorce between power and politics. Power means, ladies and gentlemen, ability to have things done. And politics is ability to select the right things to be done. Now, there was a time when I was your age when people believed, myself including, that both power and politics, the two essential, indispensable conditions of effective collective action, are in the hand of the government. And therefore, once you have decided what should prevail, what standpoint should prevail, you know who is going to do it. The government is going to do it. Now, ladies and gentlemen, people go to the squares, public squares, guided by revulsion of the government impotence, inability to select things to be done. They don't deliver on their promise because of this divorce, because huge amount of their power has evaporated into the cyberspace. It is now located in multinational corporations, in international banks, in financial powers, which have free movement around the globe and may evade any attempt of control them quite easily. So power evaporated from the government, while politics remains today in 2015 exactly in the same local encirclement, local constraint as it was 100 years ago. That is the divorce between power and politics, because in the result in this divorce you have power which is politically uncontrolled and politics which is suffering constantly of the deficit of power. And we haven't found a way of recreating on the global level the kind of democratic institutions which our grandfathers and great-grandfathers fought for, put in place, designed, and try to make working. We don't have such a new equivalent fit to the new condition. Benjamin Barber, the author of the book recently published, If the Mayors Rule the World, very provocative title, points out that nation state was an extremely efficient instrument serving the condition of local independence, territorial independence. But it is completely hopeless, he says, in serving the condition of interdependence, global interdependence in which we live now.
No. Other questions?
Hi.
Go close.
Right, okay, but address everybody, not just me.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, I have two brief questions. The first one is related to which world to choose, the offline or the online.
You have no choice.
I guess.
We've
already chosen, I guess.
Right.
Yeah, either we have chosen or we have already been chosen.
Yeah.
I guess something which can be done, especially for younger people, is to educate them to use the online world in a good way, whatever good means. I don't know what it means, but maybe we can reach a conclusion. So it's like learning how to drive a car. You can, I mean, go and against a wall, or you can drive your friends to eat something or to see a football match. The second point is whether there is a connection with the theory by Goffman, the masks by Goffman, and even the, let's say, the literary world created by Pirandello, like one, 100,000, in the sense that we can be whichever we want in different worlds, in different cities, in different moments of the day, both online and offline. So maybe the difference between the online world and the offline world is that in the latter, we are constrained by space, by time, by more resources, while in the online world, we are more free to do whatever we want and to be whatever we want.
Yeah. Right.
Okay. Other questions? May we collect other two questions? Please.
What would you answer to those who say that a real democracy? What would you answer to those who say that real democracy could better lie in internet than in a state?
Yeah, that's our question. All right.
The third one, and then we can.
Okay, I would like to reconnect to that guy's question. Okay, I don't think that we can learn a good way to use the online world. I think that we have to accept the structure of this world, because that is a already structuralized world. So do you think that there is a huge group of people who wants to use internet in a measured, responsible, and moderated way, in some way. So do you think that there will be an alternative way, and there will be a way to restructure the online world and to oppose it? Or if we want to be into this online world, we have to accept these rules?
Right. Okay.
So, we can reply.
Keep all that in mind. It's not difficult. They are very inquisitive questions, so I would like to not forget them. Can be online versus restructured. Right. I didn't try to call you to abandon one of the two worlds in which you live in order to join the other. You don't have choice. That's, I think, the departure which happened, brought about by the new opportunities created by new technologies, is probably irreversible. Unless something happens to our sources of energy, as people concerned with sustainability of the planet maintain, that suddenly there will be no energy to keep our electricity going, and therefore all internet will be over, and we will be back to the Paleolithic times. But it's, of course, a joke. It's not on the cards. Separating of the two worlds is not on the cards. And the problem is that we should try to find out and implement the way of taking the best of two possible worlds. To take the what is really positive contribution of the internet without paying the enormous price which we pay, simply being having been seduced by the facility, by the easiness, by the trouble-free nature of operating on online. You gain something, you lose something. What I'm calling you to do is not to make a choice, because there's no choice here. You have to live in both worlds as long as you stay alive, but to count your losses and to consider really what is the threat. The threat is like that, for example, losing, being confined entirely to short-term projects, because long-term requires attention, requires concentration, requires patience. And the internet does everything it can to strip you of this unpleasant need of sitting long hours and thinking, reading long books, trying to digest what you have learned, trying to fathom, to get to the depth of the issue, the bottom of the issue. These are threats to depriving you of very important skills. And that is something we can do something about. We can deliberately, willingly, and consistently try to develop these skills which we neglect to develop when we are tempted and seduced by the comforts of living in solutions or alleged solutions which are offered by internet. Well, it's another thing similar to that which I developed when speaking about the prospect of openness. When you are confronted with a comfortable, not requiring much effort, not requiring much time way of behaving, and another alternative which requires more effort, more time, more losing of energy, the likelihood, the probability is that you choose the first over the second, without thinking about the consequences, that in the long run you will be unskilled inhabitant of Earth, unskilled, not able to handle the issues which are posed in the second half of your life. It's a very difficult thing which I offer you, really. I'm not pretending that I brought you a recipe for an easy life. No, not at all. But I just try to make it clear, articulate the prices which you pay, not much thinking about it, for the gains which you joyfully embrace. Now about Goffman. Goffman we mentioned, and his question of being one or another. I think that much of his very, very profound study, made, however, in slightly different social condition, of presentation of self in public life, you know, this very, very. I remember when I first read it, it made on me impression that it was exuding the air of finality. It was the final statement. Yes, I was feeling about that is how it is. Yes, he told me that. Today, I sometimes doubt even whether we are still entitled to speak about identities. What we can speak about, I think, instead, we should speak about instead, is to speak about the identifying, a process which never ends, process which is a whole life task. And the process which could be played in very many different ways, not just in the one way when presentation of self in one vicinity, in one environment surrounding you, was analyzed by Erwin Goffman. I don't know whether there are people like you, like that among you. I don't know you personally, but quite a few people who are using internet are practicing several contemporaneous in identities, depending which network they enter. Sometimes they are invented, artificial identities. And the question of presenting them to be convincing is, of course, changing. But the very fact of, first of all, instability of identity. Every identity you assume, not by your own choice, but because of the force of the circumstances, is bound to be until further notice. And when you are working on creating and keeping your identity, your concern, a very justified concern,
is not to fix too tightly this identity, to leave options open, because the circumstances may change and suddenly to appear that your identity doesn't fit the new circumstances, you have to change it. So not fix you too strongly. How different it is from what I learned when I was your age from Jean-Paul Sartre. Jean-Paul Sartre, who was our guru, we believed him, and we had reasons to believe him, told us to select projet de la vie. Project for life, project for life, for the whole life. The kind of the identity with which you wanted, intended to spend the rest of your life. And once you selected that, what remained was resolutely, consistently, step by step, build this sort of personality, which was contained in Projet de la Vie. Well, Jean-Paul Sartre had the privilege over us. His privilege was his ignorance of what was coming, of the world which was coming. He didn't know, and therefore I don't believe that if I tell you, you select your project for life. Well, I try to do it with my students, but I have stable students, and they normally were baffled. Look at me, and those wide open eyes, and their answer was, I would be very happy if I could make a project for the next year. So that is the difference, that is the change which happened. What is the third one? Accept structure.
Real democracy.
No, I already spoke about democracy. I have nothing to accept. But the last question was accept structure already existing can be online world restructured. Well, I don't know. I simply don't know, can it be restructured or not. The technology keeps us surprised continually, and probably that was the answer, the great proof of the existence of God, that if there is something good, there must be something better than that. What follows from that is that the best available, the perfect, which can't be any further change, is also necessary to exist. I don't believe that this is the case. We are in a process. We are in the process that I don't quite see the finishing line. I mentioned to you Michel Houellebecq, his Possibility of the Island. That was the extrapolation, that dystopia was extrapolation of one trend, vivid, clear, spectacular, and very, very powerful in our present life. The trend of individualization, privatization, separation from each other, fading human bonds, making them volatile, making them flexible, and so on. And he showed us a society of people, difficult to speak about society because they didn't meet each other throughout their life. Each one inhabited its own enclave, but individuals who didn't have even father and mother because they were cloning themselves. They were practically immortal because each next clone inherited also their memory. So all their acquisitions, mental acquisitions, characterological acquisitions during life were already there. Ideal, immortality and complete freedom, unconstrained freedom. Well, it ends like that, like every dystopia used to end,
that the hero Daniel 25th, because each clone, next clone was numbered, so he was 25th, runs away from his safe enclave. He can't stand it anymore. He wants to see what he never saw, the face of another human being. And finally he finds himself on a desert, completely alone, having a very, very difficult, very dangerous journey through wilderness. And he started to count that according to his programming, he is bound to live another 60 years. He already neglected cloning, so he won't be immortal, but 60 years he still has to live. So he counts how many that makes days, how many hours, how many minutes, how many seconds he was spent more in this meaningless, emotionless life. That's one way. And the next dystopia, written by Michel Houellebecq, also extrapolates from the present trends, arriving to completely opposite results. The book called Submission. It is a story of the French election, in 2024, in which two parties came head to head on the top. One was Marine Le Pen, National Front, and the other was Muslim Brothers, the Party of Islam. It's also extrapolation. There is such a term today. They are at cross purposes. They are incompatible. But if you rely on drawing conclusion, jumping conclusion, how we look the world in 10 years' time or something like that, drawing from the current experience, you can't be sure that you are not simply fantasizing. I remember when I still was a teacher and I examined my students, and they were very nervous before examination period, and I wanted to put them in a better mood. I wonder whether you are aware that there is a branch of science called futurology, science of the future. Books, 20 years old books of futurologies, which describe, allegedly prophesies the world we lived in. And students started to laugh, and of course forgot all their worries, and were in much better shape to stand up the hardships of examinations. That's only answer I can give you honestly, really. I can't responsibly advise you how to reform internet.
Thanks a lot. Since the Professor Obama has to leave at seven, we can collect the last three questions.
Okay. Right. At 7 o'clock.
Exactly. Three questions. Please.
Hello. So glad to listen to you. However, I would like to speak a little bit in favor, if you want to, of homophily that you spoke of a lot. I totally agree that this is what most internet research is about at the moment. On the other hand, first of all, I wish it were true, because then I wouldn't be so mad about something someone wrote on the internet just a few seconds ago. So it's not perfect, and sometimes still, as a normal person, you can be very mad because the general public on the internet is not sharing your opinion, first. And second, can it not be a positive thing? Say, a different way to express homophily would be to say, like-minded people. And this is what we're all looking for, say, if you want to build up a social movement, or if you want to create a new party. I mean, it's all about people, maybe. The internet has allowed people who are living in a village and who are homosexual, for example, and they cannot express themselves and they feel they have problems in their community, they can connect to people online, and this can empower them. So can that not be, say, a first step in a process to empower people which otherwise would not have this opportunity?
Thanks a lot. Other questions?
Aspects of what?
Internet,
the question is
positive
aspect, which can
express
yourself.
Please.
I'm here. Thank you for your talk.
Hi, thanks for your talk. I want to ask you if you find any connection between the use of the internet and the reduction of loyalties.
I mean, what?
Loyalties, the reduction of loyalties. And also if you think the internet has played a role in the reduction of violence.
Of what?
Violence.
Yes, that's right.
And that's it.
Loyalties
and violence.
Last question. No more questions?
We haven't finished yet.
No, that's it.
No, you're finished. No.
There's more questions.
No, that's it. That's it.
Other questions?
Two.
Loyalty and violence.
Exactly.
Other questions? Please. The last one.
Hi, you spoke about the curses of the internet. So I think personally there are like much emphasis on the advantage of the internet, how it helps toward democratization. But on the other hand, many people tend to forget or underestimate the negative aspects of the internet itself, how it can be used, for example, for surveillance, control. So what do you think in that regard, and how can we overcome, if that is possible, or like how we take that into equation and cooperate it? So like taking into balance the advantage and also the disadvantage on the other side of the usage of the internet. Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
Well, loyalty, violence are these qualities which internet promotes. I already mentioned briefly that I feel, perhaps wrongly, but I suspect the easiness, the facility with which networks and like communities are created by simply combination of two movements, connecting and disconnecting, one and the other being childishly easy. Even 5 years old child can make how to make internet friends and how to get rid of internet misfriends. So it's so terribly easy that loyalty, which is commitment, loyalty involves commitment. You have to commit yourself, for better or worse. You must take an obligation that even if something something unpleasant happens, you will stick to this obligation. You will deliver on your promise. Now, there is no need for such obligation in establishing your personal networks. No need. No one demands from you that
This is not part of the contract, and therefore you can have the pleasure of relationship without strings attached. And if there is such an opportunity, only very strange people who are ready to sacrifice their own interests would select the more difficult thing, in spite of the fact that each of us, I suspect, dreams about real love. And real love cannot do without loyalty, long-term commitment, for better or worse, in health and illness and every other aspect of this kind. Now that is a genuine contradiction. And there is really the problem of while using the opportunity which you get from the internet, expanding your temporary revocable friendship, you can also try not to forget, learn the very difficult, damn difficult art of loving. I mean the pleasures which you can derive, contrary to internet experience, you can derive from unconditional commitment. About violence, well, ladies and gentlemen, I already talked about it. Obviously, if we are speaking about comfort zones, so we are already speaking about not mitigating antagonism between people, but on the contrary, making them even more pronounced and deeper. When you lock yourself in a gated community, you are used to a safe environment in which not a single stranger which will appear, the more you are afraid of going to the street, because you don't know how to handle the presence of strangers. You feel threatened there. There's danger after every corner waiting for you. So the opportunity of cutting yourself to the safety chamber is associated irretrievably with the possibility of feeling even more power, even more fear of the strangehood, of people whom you don't know well and who on occasion disagree with you.
And I think it's also increased by the hate speech which is developed.
Yes, but
which appears
sure.
in internet.
Aha, surveillance and control, and that's probably the last issue I want to answer. I'm terribly sorry, but it's not only late, but I am also old and I'm already tired, so I'm trying to be short, cut it short. You know about Jeremy Bentham and his panopticon. Probably that's well known to you, the story. Architectural solution to all problems of control. Keep people under constant surveillance, and the important point, that surveillance is only one directed. So some people are surveyors, the others are being surveyed. Surveyors see the surveyed, but surveyed do not know at what moment they are watched. They don't see the surveyors. And the first exemplification of a panopticon was given by Orwell in 1984. You remember Winston Smith sitting in front of a television set. There were no computers then yet. Television set. Watching television, and at some point failing to follow the command coming from television. There was an early morning exercise and he was lazy, he was tired, he didn't want to do it. And suddenly there was warning, number so and so, you are not exercising. two-way screen. From the other side of screen, like today in the inquisition rooms, in police precincts, there was two-way mirror. You know? They saw you, you never know whether you are not following command. That was panopticon. I think that panopticon since then time morphed, ramified into several different offspring, so to speak. One is what I call panopticon, P instead of P at the beginning. The difference between panopticon and banopticon is that the purpose of panopticon was to keep people in their place, to prevent them going away, to prevent them freeing themselves from this constant surveillance. Banopticon, on the contrary, is its purpose is to keep them away, not in, but out. Panopticon is applied in the big data which are paid for by big banks. Are you worthy of credit or not? Panopticon task is to check you, to test you, and to exclude you from the list of possible credit receivers. Closed circuit television. It is not there to keep the resident of the house inside. It is there to keep the non-resident outside, not allow them to go in. Or the same television camera in big supermarkets. They are there to spot loitering people who are not promising clients, who probably won't spend any money because they don't have them, and call the guards in order to expel them. Because they take the room and they frighten away the ordinary, proper kind of clients which are coming there to make purchases. So it's a panopticon for you. And the greatest advances in surveillance technology in recent years were precisely in the field of developing all sorts of panopticon devices, of keeping people away, undesirable people away. Now there is synopticon. Synopticon when the situation is reversed. Instead of few surveyors surveying the masses of the inmates in a factory or in a school or in a prison or in a hospital or whatever, we, the masses, watch the few on the screens in limelight. Celebrities. We take the advice from them. We are allowing ourselves joyfully to be tempted and seduced by their example, their style of life, their way of behaving. Well, synoptical, that's what for you. And the third offspring, which I would like to bring to your attention, is cryptoticon. I know it's a very awkward word, but I don't have at the moment a better name for it. Cryptoticon. When you are made unaware that you are being watched, you are simply not knowing what's happening. Well, what is more in this cryptoticon? That it is introduced and you are tempted to join as helpers, as assistants of this process by convincing you that it is dictated by the wish for your safety. It is for your own good that you have to reveal all this data about yourself, go through all these controls, allow yourself to be checked very, very closely all around. What are you carrying? Where are you traveling? What you are doing? Allowing yourself your email. Whenever you send an email, you are registered in Mojave Desert in the cloud computing. You are joining the big data bank. Whenever you go outside, and you always go outside with a spy in your pocket. You don't call them spy. They is your beloved iPhone, but it's a spy nevertheless, because it always knows where you are, with whom you are talking, to whom you are telephoning. And if you want, it can deliver you an exact map of all your movements in past year or two. So that's cryptoticum to you. It is all for your safety, to save you from, I don't know, international terrorists, national terrorists, local terrorists, or whatever, all sorts of dangers which threaten you. Nevertheless, the byproduct of it is collecting all the information necessary in the servers. I suggest to you that institutions like CIA, KGB, Stasi, all secret polices of the world before the advent of internet, paid over their nose in order to people to report to them, spy on other neighbors, on workmates and so on, and report on their behavior. And I suggest to you that CIA and KGB and Stasi and all other secret police together did not collect that much information about us as we willingly supply using electronic gadget. We are doing it voluntarily, and not only we are not paid for it like the spies of KGB were, but on the contrary, we pay them to spy us. That is the truth about surveillance.
Okay, that's all, I think. Thanks a lot, Professor Baumann, for the gift you have given us with this brilliant and passionate thinking. It's okay.